Nice day out there, a little chilly, huh?
Oh, yeah.
So, Gary Bailey here, professor of motocross. Gonna give you a few riding tips on doing some wood stuff. And with me, we got
Rich Lafferty.
Rich, what's your, you got a claim to fame, Rich?
2-time ECA Enduro champ and number 8 national Enduro. I actually do some riding schools back home with some amateur kids, and Gary was interested in getting some off-road stuff together, and he was nice enough to ask me to help him out.
So we figured that needed to update my original riding techniques, which is sometime about mid-80s or something. I think I shot that with David Bailey and Johnny O'Mara. I think the place to start, though, with this is basically to start talking about techniques of more control over the motorcycle, body position, control. Good place to start, this road we just came up right here. Good reason I like to work on it here, if we don't have to deal with ruts and rocks and all those issues, we just focus on body position. I think a lot of no-hander stuff, learning to use your body to control the motorcycle and your lower body. A lot of people think that the majority of this is done with the upper body, it's really done with the lower body. And so what we're going to do is we're just going to run through some drills here, show you a couple things that you can work on, and hey, we'll just take it from there, and we'll head out into the woods, and we'll find us some logs and some ruts and some high-speed stuff, and give you all the information we can possibly give you to help you to improve your riding skills, make you faster, hopefully, and safer. Okay, as I just mentioned, balance is a very important part of riding for all ages. I don't care how young or how old, and it's a good starting point for a beginner, because he can learn going very slow. It's also a very good way to start out the day so that you can get loosened up before you hit the trail. And all you need is a good, but not too steep hill, and the longer, the better. First, let me tell you the reason for what we are going to do. One, to learn to relax and control the motorcycle more with your lower body. Two, to learn that you can control the motorcycle with your lower body and not work the upper body so much. Three, to show yourself what you can do and build more confidence in the control that you have over the bike. And four, you never know what kind of a situation you are going to end up with or end up in. And this may help you pull it out. Plus, number five, it's just fun. Okay, first of all, let me tell you a couple of things to make it easier. As soon as you're going forward, put the bike in a taller gear. This way, the bike will roll more freely. Next, when just starting with one of these tricks, don't go too fast. But if you go too slow, it's more difficult, and it's more difficult to balance the motorcycle. With that said, let's start with the simple stand-up, no-hander. If you're not real sure about this, keep your hands close to the bars when you let go. Things that will help you make it easier, keep your legs straight. It's much easier to control the bike that way. Grip with your legs. Get on the balls of your feet and use your lower body, your legs, and your foot pegs to control the bike. Now, don't try to go in a straight line, because if you are stiff, you're going to be fighting the bike. If you want to go to the right, just push a little on the right-hand peg. If you want to go to the left, push on the left peg. Do this until you can make it go where you want it to go. Once you have that down, let's try sitting with no hands, using your legs mostly. Next, let's try side saddle, both legs on the left. Now, to go to the left, you're going to push on the left peg, and to go to the right, you're going to push against the tank a little with your knee. After you get that, stay side saddle. Now, it's a little tougher. Put your legs straight out to the side. No hands, and grip with whatever you can. Okay, here's the next one. I guess you'll call it the lazy boy. Kind of like a freestyle trick. Legs up on the shrouds and let her roll. Okay, got that? Next, same deal, only full on lazy boy. Flat back against the seat, Steer with your legs on the shrouds. Crazy? Oh well, let's try one more. The neck. Start off holding the bars. Take your right foot off of the peg. Put it up in the air, over the left side and on the fender. Now, take your hands off the bars, and then steer with your left foot and your left leg. Heavy on the peg, go to the left. Leg against the tank, go to the right. You may want to help this a little with your upper body leaning. You can start out with your right leg a little against the fender, then lift it all the way up. Take your time, be careful, and have fun. I know some of you are saying, is this guy crazy? He shows us this stuff and then says, be careful. Balance. We've all gotten off balance and fallen over. Well, this can help you when slow trail riding. Ride as slow as you can without putting your feet down. In fact, can you stop without touching? And how long can you stay there? When we fall over, it's just a loss of balance in the situation that we're in. Work on your balance. The more you work on it, the less you will fall over. Oh yeah, the wheelie. The wheelie can be real important for trail riding because you never know what's going to come up in front of you and you never know how quick. If it's a log, a ditch, a rock, or even a bike that's gone down, and you can't wheelie or loft over it with the front end, you could have a big problem. So let's start with a small loft. Just getting the front wheel up over a small something. Best to do this standing first. Be sure that you're in a gear that you will have some power. And if you use the clutch at the same time, when you gas it, it will help a lot. Ride along. Push on the front forks a little. We want to compress the fork springs so that you can get rebound. This way, it will make the front end easier to lift. The same way that you would bounce the front end on a bicycle to do a wheelie. Only, now you have forks to rebound, and you have the power to help. Do not plan on using the power to lift the bike into a wheelie. That's what the front forks are for. Now, as the forks are rebounding, add a little clutch and power. We are not going for speed, not for a horsepower wheelie. This is a balanced wheelie. If you need to keep the power on hard to hold the front wheel up, set it down and start over. It's best to not think about how far you can go. Think more about finding the balance point first. Then you can work on distance at slow speed control. Next, find a place to work on wheelie sitting. Again, work on a slow balanced wheelie, not power. Find the balance point and learn slow wheelies. Now, it's good to learn to do this with the rear brake so that you can have more control over your speed and there will be less chance of going over backwards. All of this balanced stuff will make everyone a better and a more confident rider.
Hey, I don't know about you, but I think that's kind of fun.
Yeah, that was really cool.
It's a good loosening up deal. Get you ready to go, warm to go, and I think it's really going to help you when you get out there on the trails to not only be more ready, but to have a better understanding of what can happen and how to fix it when you're out there on a race. It teaches you to use your lower body a lot whenever you're riding. What do you think?
Yeah, definitely. Helps with your balance issue too.
Yeah, and you know, we've seen Stuart and Reed and Carmichael and those guys do some things that were pretty crazy and pretty unbelievable. And sometimes you go, dude, how did they pull that off? Yeah. And you know, they've been in those situations before and they're comfortable with them. And I think that's an important part of it.
Before we get into more riding techniques, I want to talk about bike setup and maintenance. Here are some things to think about when setting up your motorcycle that will help you keep a better riding position and for more control. First, let's look at the bars. When buying bars, get the lowest, straightest one. Why? It will help you keep more weight forward and over the front end, which will give you more control. Some riders like the high bars because they say, well, it's more comfortable when you are standing, and maybe that's true. However, it will not let you put as much weight on the front end when you're sitting. And when you're standing, one of the most important things, if you want more control, is lean over the front end of the motorcycle a little bit more. This will enable you to get more control, and you'll have more weight on the front end. And don't roll the bars back too far, because this will make you set back too far on the bike. The best is to set your bars level, or maybe roll forward just a little bit. This will help you keep your arms up and a little more out, and your upper body more forward. Next, your levers, not too high, not too low. Run your levers a little down from level. If they are straight out, it's going to put a lot more bend on your wrists when you're using the levers. And if they are too low, it makes it very hard to try and find them. What works good is about a 30-degree angle on the brake. This way, you roll off the throttle while going for the front brake, and the clutch can be a little more level, and this will make it easier to pull. Now the gear lever. The gear lever should be level with the peg. That'll make it easiest for the upshift and the downshift. And the rear brake, it should be a little higher than the foot peg so that you won't go below the peg under braking with your toes. There will be less chance that you will catch your toe on the ground or on something. Most riders run the rear brake low so that they won't ride their foot on it. But that's not the fix for the problem. The fix is to learn to ride more on the balls of your feet as much as possible. So let's talk about that a little. Riding on the balls of your feet will let you move more freely on the pegs. It will make you lighter on the bike, and it will let you be more defensive. The balls of the feet will also help you keep more weight on the front end when you are standing. And this will help you understand it better. Get on the motorcycle, stand up in your arches, head over the front end with your legs almost straight. Now, move to the balls of your feet and you will see how much more weight goes forward. You can also do this while just standing on the ground. But remember to be leaning forward like when you are trying to keep your weight on the front end. Now, don't forget how important the front brake is too. The front brake can be about 70% of your controlled stopping. The front brake is very important to learn to use. The faster you go, the more important the front brake will be. Be sure it's not too loose. And be careful that you don't get it too tight or too touchy. Here's a good one that you can practice that will help you to know both your front and your rear brake, probably more so the rear. Sit on your motorcycle on the stand and get a feel with your foot. First, be sure that you have your riding boots on. Now, you will need to do this standing and sitting. Touch your boot to the brake pedal so that you can feel it. As soft as possible. Now, push it all the way down to the point that you know that it would be locked up. Now, let up on the pedal and push to the point that you think it would almost be locked up. And be sure that you know the feel on the bottom of your boot. If you have trouble stalling the bike, you need to learn a better feel. So, just keep working on it standing and sitting, and you will get it better. Now let's talk about body position and how you can get the most control and why. Let's start with sitting. Always try to stay on the front of the seat as much as possible. The more you stay on the front of the motorcycle, the more control that you will have of where the motorcycle is going. If you can't get the front end to go where you want it to go, then the rear end is not going to go there either. So stay forward as much as possible. Try to keep your arms up and out when in the flat, wide open areas. for better leverage and control. And of course, as you get in those real close, tight areas, you will need to pull your arms in so that you don't smack the trees. Then, when you get ready to stand up, do just that, stand up. Most riders squat. Take a look at most riders when they are standing, or say they are standing. And here's why it's better to stand than to do whatever this position is called. Oh, I can call it the dump position. I guess you can figure out why I call it that. Now, when you stand up, straighten your legs. That's right. Stand more like you do when you are standing, talking to someone. And I know you're not in some kind of a squat dump position. This will also let you relax your legs more when you are up on the pegs. But even more important, it will help give you more control and stability of the rear end with your legs straight and back more. When you stand, try to keep your knees behind the pegs as much as possible. Why behind the pegs? Because this will let you grip the rear of the bike better and easier, and there will be less kicking and swapping at the rear. With your legs bent, there is no way that you can stop the rear end and keep it from getting loose. And if you are on the balls of your feet, it's even easier to get your knees back behind the pegs. And here's another big advantage. The more you straighten your legs, the more weight goes on the front. So you get more control of the front end and the rear end. Oh, one more thing. If you don't keep your head over the front end and your back arched, this will not work well. I will tell you this. If you look at the top national riders, this is what they will look like. Oops, I said one more thing. Well, there's two. When you stand up and straighten your legs, don't straighten your arms. Always keep a small bend in your arms, always. Okay, let's talk maintenance just a little bit because it is a very important part of riding and being safe. Keep your motorcycle clean. It's not just important for the look, it's also important to show pride in your motorcycle. And it's easy to find things that have come loose and that you need to fix. When you are washing the bike, clean all the little hidden spots. This way you will find any little cracks that may be there, loosened nuts or bolts, or anything that could fall off. Always check the air filter, even if it wasn't that dusty, just in case for some reason it's come loose. Lube the chain as soon as you wash the bike while it's still wet. In fact, if you want to keep your motorcycle looking real good and shiny, as soon as you finish washing it, spray the whole bike with a lightweight oil, then wipe it down. I always do this before I dry it. And be sure you don't get any oil on the disc brakes. If you do, spray with carb or contact cleaner to remove any of the oil that may have gotten on the discs. Of course, checking the cables is important, and it's a good idea to keep the clutch cable lubed as well as the lever where the cable goes into the lever. This point is very important if you want an easy pulling clutch. After every ride, it's a good idea to check your clutch oil and to change it regularly so your clutch will last longer. And today we have four strokes, and one of the biggest problems with them is that all of us two-stroke guys forget the importance of checking the oil and changing it regularly. It should be checked after every time you ride. Plus, it's a real good idea to change the filter every time you change the oil. And if you're riding a 250F, some of them use a lot more oil than the 450s do, so keep a close eye on it. And always check the air in the tires. They may have a slow leak, and if it sits around for a long time, it will lose air pressure. And here's a good idea. Make a weekly checklist. Oh, and here's another good idea. check the bike every week and use the checklist. And now for the clutch. Learning how to use your clutch right is very important. But if you're not in the right gear to start with, the clutch is not the answer. Don't abuse the clutch. The clutch is there to help you with power and with traction to make it better at all times. But first, be sure you're in the right gear. The gear you're in should have good power or almost the perfect power without the clutch. Then, the clutch is there so that you can control the power to the rear wheel even better. Like on an uphill. To start with, a little clutch will help the power come on a little quicker and with a little bit more control at the bottom. Then, going up the hill, you may want to keep the rear wheel from spinning so that you'll have more traction. And you may want to keep it from getting too much traction so you can pull it in just a little or slip it up the hill. Then, once you get to the top, you can keep the front end from coming up too much. Or when you get to the top of the hill, you may need to pull the clutch a little to keep it from stalling or to build a little power to control so that you can pull away. Keep your finger on the clutch. Yes, one is better than two. Why? Well, first of all, you can hold on better with one finger on the lever than you can with two. And you won't need to pull it in as far when you need to use it. Plus, with two fingers, you are more likely to pull it in too far and snap it out faster, making more of a problem. Always use it slowly so that you can make a stronger and a smoother and more controlled power. Use it, but don't abuse it. Oh yes, one more good reason to keep your finger on the lever at all times on the trail. You never know what's going to come up next. Even if you need to stop quickly, you can pull the clutch in without stalling the bike.
All right, this one's real important. Do it as slow as possible. Keep your body forward, grip the bike, stay loose, and remember to feed the clutch. You should be able to use your throttle, high RPMs, low RPMs, still maintain a good traction and good forward momentum if you got it right. Let's talk about the uphill now. Start with an easy one, we'll go to the tougher one later. When you go up the hill, you got to again make sure that you've got very good traction and good body position. If you get too far back on the back of the bike, front end's gonna come up, you're gonna do a loop out, you're gonna have a problem. You gotta be able to control your traction, power, body position, and best when you're practicing this, going slowly, try to make sure when you get to the top, the front end doesn't pop up on you. Try to keep the front end down as much as you can. Do it as slow as possible first. Learn how to control, get traction, then you can try and go faster and jump or whatever it is you wanna do after that.
Okay, uphills can be fun if your body position is right. If not, I would say it's probably not that much fun. So, let's sum it up. Going uphill, make sure that you're going at the hill with a positive attitude. You're going to make it. Be sure you're in a gear that is going to have a good power and not bog. Stay forward on the bike. Head over the bars and try to stay that way all the way up the hill. As you start from the bottom, have enough power that you can coast the last half bike length if you need to. Why? Because something may go wrong going up the hill and you may lose traction. If so, you need to be sure that you have enough momentum. If not, keep going back down. Not good. Give it a little clutch at the bottom to make sure that you have a strong drive. Now, as you are going up the hill, feed the clutch a little. It may even need a little slip. This way, you won't have too little or too much traction or power. Then, as the front wheel just gets to the top and the rear wheel is coming over, pull the clutch in a little to help keep the front end down And as soon as you do that, be sure that you get back on the power along with a little clutch to pull away. And you also probably won't stall this way. As far as the body, the more you are forward, the more your legs are straight, and the more grip you have with the motorcycle, the more traction and control that you are going to have.
Let's talk about the downhill just a minute. I don't know what you experienced, Sir Rich, but most of the guys that I find seem to think that when they get to the downhill, they want to get on the back of the bike going downhill. Pretty much what you experienced?
Yep, exactly.
Good idea, bad idea?
I think it's a bad idea.
For what reason do you think?
Takes too much weight off the front end.
You know what? And going down a hill, well, I sure wouldn't want to lose my front end. I know that.
No.
I mean, getting that front end turned, snatching a rock, catching a rut. If you're on the back of the bike, you don't have any control over that.
Yeah.
So the idea is, actually, when you get to the top of the hill, you want to have your head way over the front end. What a lot of people don't realize is as the bike drops over the hill, it's going to tend to pull you to the back a little bit anyway. Mm-hmm. If you're already back there, now you lose control over the motorcycle. So as you approach the hill, usually standing up is a real good idea. You approach the hill standing up, your head's over the front end of the bike, make sure that your finger's on the clutch, and make sure that as you drop off the top, your throttle doesn't go wide open. So make sure you're kind of rolled in a forward position. If you have the front brake coming up to the top of the hill, be sure when you drop off that you let go of the front brake, because you certainly don't want to grab that going down the hill. Not going to be pretty.
No.
It's real important. Make sure that you're able to control your speed going down the hill. The steeper the hill, longer the hill, bigger the problem. Make sure when you drop off the top, you got both brakes very easily. Let go of the brakes as you drop over the top. Then make sure you're ready to use both those brakes when you get to the bottom to be able to stop. Once your speed builds, you got a problem. So Rich, you ready for something a little tougher?
Definitely.
How about the waterfall?
Okay.
Little bit of ledges coming down now. You don't have the smooth trail. You know what, when you get to the top of this though, get up there, take a good look at it, find your route you want to come down, and here's the most important thing when I look at a downhill. If it's square in the bottom, I'm going to think twice. No, I'm going to think three or four or five times about whether I want to go down it. But if it's rounded, if it's got it kind of swooped out at the bottom, you know what, I'm looking at it going, no matter what happens going down that hill, I can probably pull it off as long as I got a run out that doesn't compress the forks and flip me over the handlebars. What do you think?
Definitely, yeah.
All right, well, let's take a look at it and see what it looks like. From the top side. The waterfall. Yeah. Why do I call this the waterfall? Because the water falls off here every time it rains. And every time I come here, it looks worse. As a matter of fact, it looks worse.
I know, dude.
There used to be a little bit of a runoff here.
Last time we looked at it, it was pretty bad.
Hey, Rich, you know what we could do?
What?
We could let you go down here first. Make sure when you get to this steep hill that you got a lot of confidence. Don't lock up the brakes, particularly the front wheel coming to the top. You look at this downhill and you just see what I'm talking about. It's a little bit steeper than before. And you can go down them not only steeper, but you can go down them a lot bigger than this one right here. But you don't want to panic. You don't want to get tense. And you definitely don't want to get down here and lock up the rear brake or the front brake for that matter. What were you thinking when you pulled up to the top over here on the right-hand side?
Like, holy smoke, dude. I'm not going down that.
or why am I going down that? It, you know what, up here looking at it, it's a whole lot different than it is sitting down at the bottom, and I'm going, oh yeah, let's go over there and go down the waterfall.
Yeah,
it's definitely got a bit of a drop, and I'll tell you what I wouldn't want to do. I wouldn't want to come up here going too fast. No. I don't think there would be anything pretty about that. No. What are we talking here? We're talking body position, clutch control. By the way, we're talking body position and clutch control in everything that you do. The better your power application is to the rear wheel, the better your body position is, the easier life is going to be in every situation that you're in. Yeah, so now we're going to talk about downhill. And I'm not just talking about this or this. I'm talking a little more about this, with a little bit of this going into this and then ending up down in the bottom like that. Hopefully not laying in the creek. And the hill right here. Hey, Rich, how do you like this one?
It's nice. Pretty hill. Nice, yeah.
Okay, as we have already talked about, body position here is the most important thing. Don't get back too far. You can have your butt back, but you need to have your head forward over the bars. You must have control of the front end. If you lose that, you're done. Look where you want to go before you drop off the top. When you first drop off the top, keep your head forward, because when the bike drops, you will go to the rear. And always drop over slow. The faster you go, the harder it is to stay against the hill, and the more the rear end is going to kick up as you go off. Again, at the top, both brakes, and always keep your right foot so that you can use the rear brake. Stopping at the top with the front brake only can be bad, so be careful, and when you reach the bottom, don't panic and grab the front brake. Another bad idea. Oh, and I think I just said, when you drop over the hill, pick your line. Well, if there's a wet, slippery rock down in the bottom, make sure you don't hit that. And then, once you're laying on the ground, watch out if help's coming, because you never know what's going to happen next.
So how was that, Mr. Rich?
That was pretty cool. That was a lot of fun.
Pretty high speed right there. Definitely got to watch that branch. You know, that brings me to the point. A lot of people don't look far enough ahead, and I don't think they'd see that branch till it was slapping them across the face.
Definitely.
And you know what? Let's talk about visors just a minute. A lot of problems with a lot of guys, particularly beginners. They run the visor too low, and because the visor's so low, they don't have any visibility when they're looking down here. They can't see out in front of them. And it's pretty difficult to ride with your head up like this and have any control. So if you're trying to ride aggressive and watch what's in front of you, it's hard to watch right here and look up there at the same time if your visor is too low.
Yeah.
So I think that's a real problem. Other thing is, you got to be careful and watch out for these G-outs. G-outs meaning down there in that bottom, there's pretty good little force down there in the bottom. I don't know what you're feeling, but, you know, of course, what do you weigh?
About 170.
Yeah, see, I weigh 230, so I'm probably getting more G out than you are down in the bottom. But yeah, definitely you got to watch out for that. What do you think some of the things that you really got to pay attention to here, or some of the biggest issues are as far as technique coming through this section?
One of the things that comes to mind right away is where your foot position is. Riding on the balls of your feet, having more shock absorber kind of effect with your ankles.
And that's what it does, you know. And a lot of guys, particularly when you ride in the woods and you get in the real tight stuff, they go, well, man, I don't have time. But, you know, when you're in the tight stuff, you're going to be more in your arches. You're going to spend more time with your foot over the brake because you got to constantly use it all the time.
Yeah.
But once you get down to that open area, it's definitely a lot. I mean, the more you can be on the balls of your feet, even in the tight stuff, if you could do it, the problem is you can't because everything's happening so fast. But that does give you a little bit more shock absorber and just makes it a lot easier on your suspension and body and flow. You know, and it also, a lot of people don't realize this, when you get on the balls of your feet, it also changes your body positioning and transfers a little bit more weight up onto the front end of the bike as well.
Yeah.
So, some of the things to look for. I don't know, that was kind of fun, huh?
Yeah, that's kind of cool.
Good stuff.
So here's the problem in this situation that most riders need to work on. First of all, they need to pay more attention to the power. Make sure you're in the right gear and try to use your clutch to build a stronger and a better power to the rear wheel. Next, body position. Whether you're standing or whether you're sitting, stay forward on the bike. If you're standing, particularly, be on the balls of your feet as much as possible. Good to do that even when you're sitting. The other problem is, when you stand up, don't squat. Be more aggressive, be more in control, and build a better power. Well, here's one that riders seem to have a problem with, for some reason, the water crossing. And most of the problems are because they just don't have enough power crossing the water. Why? I think it's because they can't see what's in the water. So they go real slow, and that's not always a good idea. You don't need to go fast, but you do need to start and keep up your forward momentum and your power. Stay on the power all the way through. Don't stop your forward momentum. Keep the bike moving. Stay forward on the bike. And to help you stay forward, grip with your legs. Even if you need to put your foot down or your feet down. And use your feet, still you need to stay forward, as far forward as possible. And you do that mostly by gripping with your legs. And if you try to go through with just the throttle and something goes wrong, you are going to get stuck. So, as you start into the rut or into the deep water that you're not sure what is there, feed or slip the clutch a little. Keep the bike moving and keep the power up. Never stop your forward momentum. And when it comes to ruts, it's a good idea to keep your arms up and out as much as possible for more control over the front end. You don't need to go that fast, but you do need to keep the front end light and keep it pushing through. And once the front end gets too deep in the rut, the forks are going to start to drag, and that's not good. And if the front wheel gets stuck, it's then hard to get out. Should there be roots in the rut, and your front wheel or your rear wheel stop against it, that's a real problem. If this happens, back up a little so that you can get some kind of forward momentum to help you get over it. Bottom line, stay forward, keep your power up, feed the clutch all the way through, and be smooth with your clutch and your power.
So, what do you think the toughest part of this is?
The loose rocks?
Yeah. The rut's not that bad. If it was smaller, a little bit deeper, it could be a problem. But the loose rocks, they jump all over the place.
Yeah.
Biggest deal here. And I think that deal we did going down the hill with no hands and all that stuff where you learn to use your lower body, I think that's real critical here because you got to use a lot of lower body here.
Okay.
Got to use your pegs, you got to use your legs. And you know the other thing that'll really help, I think, everybody, and not only in this situation, but going up their hills and down their hills, stay loose and be defensive. Stay loose and move. I talk a lot about a tennis player, how he stands there and he's always got this little back and forth motion, or a boxer standing there and he's always up there and he's kind of getting ready to punch, he's getting ready to pull, but he keeps moving, he doesn't just stand there. You got to have that defensiveness about you and be ready for problems, because if you're not ready for problems, dude, they're going to bite you in the butt.
Yeah.
And I think that's the issue here, because now we got something that gets thrown on us every time. It's a little different. It's never exactly the same. It depends on how the rocks move around.
Yeah. I think clutch control is crucial here too, because if something happens, you got to be ready for it.
You know, and while we're talking about clutch control, you know, when we were going up the hill, and particularly that last hill we were going, to steep one where the bike kept jumping up in the air, you know, the other night I was sitting watching Last Man Standing race, and I was just watching some of those guys go up there going, God, I can't believe how many of those guys are throwing it away. And I honestly believe a lot of that is because they don't have a hold of the clutch. They don't have a feel for the clutch, so they can't keep the bike and the power and the traction completely under control. So the bike ends up just launching out from underneath them.
Corners, corners, corners. When it comes to turns, we have wide open, high speed, lots of rutted turns, off cambers, and tons of tight wooded turns. So, let's start with the more wide open turn. Set down as early as you can, at least as early as possible. If it is a left-hander, you can get set down early because the rear brake is on the right-hand side. This way, you can set down, do your downshift, put your leg out, and be ready for the turn well before you get there. This means that you can start laying the bike over and come in more aggressive. Plus, you can use the rear brake with more control if you are already sitting down. When sitting down braking, don't worry about trying to have your foot on the peg. because if you are sitting forward where you should be, you can't have your foot on the foot peg anyway, and that's okay. And practice braking with a good feel of the brake. You need to learn the feel on the bottom of your boot, when it's touching, when it's going to lock up, and when it's almost going to lock up, for perfect braking. The feel you get before lockup. Learn not to lock up the rear wheel. Let the compression of the motor, along with the downshift, the front brake, and the rear brake, help you to get better and more controlled braking. Have your finger on the clutch lever, but don't pull it in entering the turn. When in the center of the turn, pull it in a little so that you are ready to help get a stronger and a more controlled power coming out of the turn. Set forward. The more forward, the more weight on the front. Try to keep your outside arm up and out. This will help the front end to stick better. Grip the bike with your outside leg. This will help lay the bike over and so that you won't slide back on the seat on the exit. Weight the outside peg and you may sit a little on the outside edge of the seat, particularly in a flat turn or an off camber. When it comes to rutted turns, again, stay forward. Here, you will need to use your clutch a little more. As soon as you drop into the rut, start your power, but do it smooth. If you hit it hard or fast, it will want to stand up and jump out of the rut. This is a good place to feed the clutch more. In fact, if it is a long, deep rut, you may even want to feed the clutch or slip the clutch all the way through. Biggest problem in the rut, a decreasing power or no power. Practice standing and practice sitting. Work on both. High speed, wide open, most of the time, sit down. Slow, tight, more stand up. Work on both when practicing. Nothing is carved in stone. Sometimes when you're in the real tight wooded area, it's difficult to sit down, get your leg out, lean the bike over because of the trees on the inside. So you may do a little bit more stand up. Keep your finger on the clutch because you never know when you are going to need it. Another reason you want to keep your finger on the clutch is that in those real tight wooded areas with no ruts, you may even want to use your rear brake to slide the rear end around a little bit so that you can make a quicker and a tighter turn. So, what about off cambers? Number one, never make a radical power change. Keep your power smooth and steady. Weight the outside peg. Stay forward. Sit a little on the outside edge of the seat, and your head leans a little bit more to the inside. So does your upper body. And if you have tree roots or a log in the corner, be sure that you don't power when your rear wheel is on it. Use your power smooth before, ease off a little, and back on the gas again. Now I want to take a minute and talk about looking ahead. Something that I think is a big problem. Riders don't pay enough attention to what's ahead. The faster you go, the further you need to look ahead. Sure, you need to pay attention to the things that you're dealing with that are just in front of you. However, every chance you get, take a glance up the trail. This way, you will know which way the trail goes, and you will see if there are any problems ahead. And this way, you will be more ready to deal with what's coming. Even the top riders in motocross try to keep an eye on the next section whenever possible so that they can come out aggressive to the next jump or the next section with speed and with confidence. And so do the fastest woods guys. You never know what's coming next. And if there's a hill or a creek crossing and it looks like there's a lot of traffic, be sure to look ahead, pick your line, and know where you're going to go and don't stop your forward momentum. Now let's talk about the young ones going over a small log in the trail. First problem, maybe is ground clearance. If that's the case, the slower you go, the better the chances are that you will get hung up on the log. So come up to it slow, Then as the front wheel starts over, give it a little power. When the front wheel hits the log, it will bounce a little, helping to hop the front end up just a little, giving the bottom of the motorcycle more clearance. Then, as the center of the bike gets over, it will come to the rear wheel. Don't stop, or the rear tire is going to spin on the log. If you keep forward momentum, the rear wheel will do the same as the front wheel. It will bounce over a little, and you don't need to go that fast. You just need to keep moving, and a little clutch will help to control the power and the traction. As for the big guys, you can do the same thing, or you can work on a wheelie over the log. Do a wheelie just high enough to get the front end to the top of the log. As soon as it touches the log, give it a little more power so that the front end won't slam down on the other side of the log. If you want the rear wheel to not kick up real bad, you will need to stay on the power a little as the rear wheel is going over the log. You can do this without the clutch. However, it is easier to loft the front end and control the power at the rear wheel if you use the clutch. Not only do we need to control the power with the clutch, but we need to control the speed. Little guys and gals need help. Why? Why doesn't anyone ever teach the new riders some of the most simple, basic things before they turn them loose? Like the simple bump start. Most riders have no clue. It's so easy. Just put them on a small downhill with the motorcycle in neutral, start it rolling, pull in the clutch, click it into second gear, bounce on the seat, and slip the clutch out a little, and presto, you're running. And why not make them learn to take off at the bottom of a small uphill? This way, they will learn more about the clutch and the power and how it works to help them out on the trail to keep them out of trouble. And what about just turning in small circles, using the clutch to control the turn, to control the power and the speed? This way, they won't need a football field just to turn around. Why do we not teach them how important the clutch is? And most riders don't even know how to use the brakes properly. Why? How can we tell a rider to ride safe when we don't even teach them how to use the clutch, the brakes, the proper riding position when standing and sitting for each situation on the trail? No matter what your riding level is, proper clutch, proper braking, and proper body position will help your rider. Sure, we can talk them into going through the creek, and we can talk them into going up hills, but wouldn't it be better if they learned a little bit more about the clutch and about gripping the bike and keeping their feet on the pegs and having more control over the motorcycle? And all of the new riders seem to have this problem, even older riders that don't know how to grip the bike, don't know how to keep their feet on pegs, and don't know how to use their clutch. There's a good chance that they're going to crash. There's no question about that. You need to learn the proper techniques from the beginning about being able to control the bike better at all times. Even the older guys let your arms drop down, get too far back, and the next thing you know, you're laying on the ground. Sitting too far back on the bike is a problem. You can't control where it's going. Not knowing how to use your clutch properly and smooth and grip the bike and stay forward. Keeping forward momentum. Again, using the clutch properly. And once you get stuck, it's real important, particularly if there's a tree root there, that you don't sit there and try and spin the tire because you're not going anywhere when there's no traction. Best get on the motorcycle, back up a half a bike length, let out the clutch, start going forward, and get your momentum going and save your energy and get yourself up the hill. Keeping on the front of the motorcycle, keeping your arms up and your head forward so that you can keep a good forward momentum. and being able to control the motorcycle at all times, not getting too excited with the power. Again, sitting on the front of the bike will give you more control and learning how to use that clutch. All of these should be crashes. And how many times can you make those same mistakes over and over before you're laying on the ground? And I decided to get Mr. Rich to demonstrate what happens if you don't get enough momentum crossing the creek and if the hillside gets wet. And I even asked him, Rich, could you demonstrate that a few more times for us so we can kind of see exactly what the problems are? You need to keep your momentum going through the creek. And of course, the more water that gets on the hillside, the worse it is. If you don't have a good momentum going through the creek, it's pretty obvious that there's not much traction on that uphill. The wetter it gets, and obviously there's a lot of tree leaves there, so the traction is minimal. Keep your weight forward. Feed the clutch all the way through, and you will get to the top as long as you keep a good forward momentum going all of the time. And I even asked Rich, would you demonstrate that uphill one more time? The one that you'd already made about three or four times? Show him what happens if you get too far back. Oh yeah, give us your good run, Rich. Atta boy. Now that looks good. Good body position, good grip, and good stance. So again, we decide to do the downhill and demonstrate how you do it properly. Problem, there's that wet rock again. And look out, because, well, the cameraman's not doing a very good job here. I think he's a little excited. And now comes help. Help. I think that's something that we both need right at this moment. Well, it's all in good fun. And, gee, getting a little wet's not all that bad when it's warm out. But it wasn't warm. And on the uphill, let's try doing it with the legs bent and the arms down and see what kind of control and forward momentum that we have. Then as soon as we do that, let's do it with the legs straight. Once the legs are straight, the fingers on the clutch, nice smooth feed, better control, better traction, and good leg grip. Proper body position, proper power application. That's what this is all about. Being smooth and getting good traction to the rear wheel.
Whenever possible, keep your legs as straight as you can possibly keep them, and keep your knees back behind the foot pegs. Rich, you know what the bike, stand up and on the pegs. Keep your knees behind the pegs. What this does, this enables you to have more traction on the rear end, because your butt's to the rear, and it allows you to have very good control over the front end of the bike, because now it's actually, when you straighten your legs, it's transferred weight forward. Bend your knees. When you bend the knees, that takes weight and puts it on the back end, gives you less stability of the front end of the motorcycle. So now you're gonna be fighting the front end coming up. This is better traction and more control with your legs straighter, your arms up, and your head over the front end.
Well, from the professor here, I wanna thank you for watching Trail Riding Tips. And remember, only perfect practice makes perfect. Don't forget to work on your clutch control, throttle control, body positioning, and proper braking. And yes, by the way, when you have those little guys and gals that are just learning to ride, please teach them the proper techniques. Ride safe and have a good time.
Because I'm going to do the old man I'm chicken route. Excuse me while I cover up this shiny spot here. There might be a glare. Ah, all right, we fixed the glare. And then when we get all done, Rich is going to show us how to come up it. Now, why am I not going to tell you? Because I'm old and smart. And Rick isn't that old. I'm either.
Superstar!